You know what my favorite game is? Dodgeball. I think in my school we called it battle ball, but the idea was the same. You threw these balls at each other and you tried to dodge them. It was epic. It turns out that's all about throwing things, and we call anything thrown in physics a projectile. So if you can learn to dodge that ball, you can dodge any projectile, even a wrench. You can dodge anything. In this lesson, we're going to learn all about projectile motion, throwing things. We're going to take a look specifically at an example with a home run. Let's learn. Let's begin by considering our lesson objectives. First, we'll define projectile motion, so you know just what we're looking at. Then we'll introduce the important steps for solving projectile motion problems. At the same time, we'll solve a projectile motion problem. So we'll go back and forth between 2 and 3, introducing a step and then using it, and then repeating that so that you get a really good idea of how to solve these problems. Baseball is all about the motion of a projectile, the ball. First, a pitcher considers just how hard to throw a ball and to what spot. The batter watches carefully, tries to predict that location, and if he's lucky, a hit. The outfielder scrambles. There's no time to do math. He has to do physics in his head and try to predict where the ball will land and to move himself to that spot. So close. What exactly is projectile motion? It's just predicting the motion of an object after it's launched at an initial velocity, just what the outfielder and the batter are trying to do. What forces do we consider in projectile motion? Well, the forces we consider in projectile motion are just gravity. The only important force is gravity. You might be thinking, well, shouldn't we consider air resistance because isn't air all around the baseball? And that's totally true, but we're going to ignore it, just to keep things simple. So air resistance is considered to be zero. We have no forces of friction. All right, let's introduce the problem we'll solve in this lesson. A baseball is hit at a height of 1 meter with a velocity of 36 meters per second and an angle of 22 degrees. Will the ball clear a 3 meter tall fence 65 meters from home plate? Basically, the question is saying, 65 meters away, will the ball have a height above 3 meters? We're really asking, will this be a home run? Because if it clears that fence, we know what that means, home run. What are the steps we'll use to solve this problem? Well, the very first thing we need to do is to sketch the problem and identify the directions. So now, like I said, we'll go ahead and do that step and then come back and consider the next one. Here, we're going to consider the horizontal direction, the x direction, to be the direction along the field from the home plate to the wall. We know that that goes about 65 meters and we'll call the home plate 0. So that's where 0 is going to be. For the vertical direction, we'll consider the direction of the wall, where the ground is considered 0, and the wall is going to be at 3 meters. So now we can actually put our question in terms of these x and y variables. We want to know if at x equals 65 meters, is the y of that ball greater than 3 meters? We don't need to know the exact height, really. We just need to know that it's above 3 meters. Because if it's above 3 meters, that's a home run. All right, what's the next step? The next step is to split our knowns into x and y components. This is just what we did in our last lesson. So now we'll grab those trig equations with sine and cosine and use them. We know that the velocity in the y direction is equal to the initial velocity times sine theta, and that the velocity in the x direction is equal to the initial velocity times cosine theta. And we're given everything we need to use these equations. Let's solve for the vertical velocity. It's going to be equal to 36, that was the initial velocity, times sine 22, because that's the angle at which it's hit. And if we plug that into our calculator, we should get 13.5. I'm going to put dot, dot, dot there to remind us to keep all those digits so that we'll use them throughout the problem. Don't round them here. We want to keep them all so we don't accumulate what's called round off error. Here is just a warning. Keep the full numbers in your calculator or write down to 6 or so decimal places so that we don't get that round off error. If you didn't get 13.5 meters per second, then know that that means your calculator was not in degree mode. One last time, remember, keep the full number in your calculator or write it down. All right, let's solve for the velocity in the x direction. Here we'll plug in 36 times cosine of 22 degrees. So we use cosine now instead of sine, and that'll give us a velocity in the x direction of 33.4 meters per second. So we've completed step two. We split apart our velocity into its components. And we'll add those to the bottom of our problem just to keep track of them. Okay, what's the next step? I've listed two steps here. We want to list the knowns and unknowns and identify the relevant equations. This should remind us a lot of our kinematic problems. Here's the thing though, you don't know the equations yet. So now let's introduce those equations, and then we'll go to step three where we list the knowns and unknowns. To think about the equations, we'll start with our kinematic ones. Here we have all five of our kinematic equations that we've used before. And what we're going to do is use these in two directions, the x and the y. So basically, I can just use these exact equations in the x and the y. To do that, we'll substitute in specific variables for the x-axis. We'll use velocity sub x for the average velocity. We'll use x sub f for the final displacement. And we'll use x sub 0 for the initial displacement. Let's substitute those all in. Okay, that's a lot of equations, so don't get overwhelmed here. We're going to quickly reduce those. How are we going to do that? Well, we need to remember something about the horizontal velocity. Do you remember from the last lesson what we learned? We learned that it remains constant. That means that the acceleration in the x direction is equal to zero, which means that our average velocity is equal to our initial velocity and our final velocity. Why is all of that true? Because the velocity is not changing, so it's the same at the beginning, the middle, and the end. And when we take that into account, we actually just have one equation in the x direction, which is really helpful. Anytime you're solving for anything in the x direction, that's your equation. Our y direction, we can do the same thing with, where we substitute in v sub y or y for all of those different variables. Here we do get a wide number of equations. Still, altogether, we have five equations for our projectile motion problems. Here's the thing to remember about the y velocity. The y velocity does change. Do you remember why? It's gravity. It changes only due to gravity. And what is the acceleration due to gravity? Well, it's minus 9.8 meters per second squared. In other words, the acceleration in the y direction is just minus g. So what we'll do to generate our final projectile motion equations is plug in minus g. Now that we've plugged in minus g, we have all of our projectile motion equations. Write these down. Keep them nearby whenever you have to do one of these problems. One quick note here. There's only one variable that shows up in both of these lists. What is it? If you guessed time, you're exactly right. So time is the only variable that is the same across both directions. And what that often means is that we'll solve for time in one direction and then use it in the other, as we actually will in this problem. Okay, at long last, we return to our list of steps. List the knowns and unknowns, and then identify the relevant equation. So let's list our knowns and unknowns now that we know what variables we're using. I've listed out the variables we're going to find here as the initial displacement and the y direction. What is that? Well, that's just where our projectile starts in the y. It doesn't start on the ground. Remember that the baseball is hit a meter above the ground. And so that means our initial height is 1 meter. What's our final height? Well, we want it to be above 3 meters. That's actually what we're going to solve for. And if we find it's above 3 meters, we know it's a home run. So that's what we're looking for. What's our initial x displacement? Well, the batter hits the ball at home plate, which remember we defined as zero. So our initial x displacement is zero. What is our final x displacement? Well, it's how far away the wall is. That fence is at 65 meters. What about time? Time is actually something we don't know. So we'll list there a question mark. Gravity, we of course know, is 9.8 meters per second squared. Okay, so we've listed our knowns and unknowns. We have two unknowns there. What's the next step? Well, we want to solve for those knowns or unknowns, right? We're going to use the knowns and solve for the unknowns. Here's our strategy. First, we're going to find time when the ball is at the fence. So we're going to use the x information to find time. Once we have that time, we can use that time in the y direction to find height. So let's start by finding how long it takes to get to the fence. So the only equation in the horizontal direction is x sub f equals vx times t plus x sub 0. So that's the only equation, and it has time, and we know all the variables in it. What is x sub f? It's 65 meters. We know the velocity in the x direction from step 2 is 33.4 meters per second. We don't know time, and we know the initial x displacement is 0, so we get 65 equals 33.4 times t. Okay, how do I solve this? Well, first of all, I can just realize that the 0 drops off. Then I need to isolate t. How will I isolate t? I'll isolate t by dividing both sides by 33.4. When I do that, the 33.4 on the right cancels out, and I get 65 divided by 33.4, which equals 1.95 seconds. Again, I've used all the dots there because we haven't found our final answer. So I'm going to keep all of those digits as I go to the next part of my problem. Now that I've found the time, I'll add that to my list of knowns, and I'm actually ready to go ahead and solve for that y height. How high is the ball at 65 meters out? So look through your equations. Is there any equation you see that gives us the final height and has time, the height and the y initially, and gravity? Well, there is one. It tells us that the final height is equal to the initial height plus the velocity in the y direction times time, and then we subtract that gravity term. Let's go ahead and plug in what we know. We know y0 is 1. We know velocity in the y direction is 13.5. We know time is 1.95. And we know gravity, 9.8. When we plug that all in, we get 1 plus 13.5 times 1.95. Minus 1/2 times 9.8, that's our gravity, times our time squared, 1.95 squared. All right, we can just go ahead and straight up solve for that. No algebra needed. We get 8.6799... meters. Here, we want to round to 2 sig figs because many of the numbers in our problem have just 2 sig figs. So we'll round to 2 sig figs, and that 7 tells us to round up. So we get 8.7 meters. Is that above the wall? Well, yeah, it is. Home run, baby. That's right. We got ourselves a home run because our projectile was above that wall. All right, one last set of practice problems for you. What I want you to do is think through each one of these and indicate if they're true or false. So pause the video and think through them. All right, here are the answers. The horizontal velocity changes over time. That's false. The horizontal velocity just stays the same. B says time is the only variable that connects the horizontal and vertical. That's true. Time is the only one that shows up on both those lists. C says gravity and air resistance are the only forces considered in projectile motion. Well, here remember that we ignored air resistance, so that's false. Lastly, you should round numbers frequently when solving a problem. That's false. We want to keep them all in our calculator. All right, what have we learned? We've defined projectile motion. We've said that it's just the motion of something in the air that we've launched with some initial velocity, and we're going to track its motion over time. We've introduced the important steps for solving projectile motion problems, and we used them to solve our first problem. We did solve a projectile motion problem. Now, here's the thing. You need more practice. So if you still feel a little uncomfortable, that's totally normal. And in our next lesson, we'll practice continuing to solve projectile motion problems. Hey, hey.